literary devices in the exhibits?
Yeah.
Anybody find any?
Beans Begin.
Beans Begin? What's that?
It's
alliteration?
Typically traveled in other alliteration. Society and settlement.
The main literary device I saw was alliteration, simply because it's museum exhibits written. I mean, they're written to be informative and factual, and, you know. Anybody find anything else besides alliteration?
Jim has some.
They have faces as beautiful as white milk, Juliet 1705.
There you go. And the one that Sue had about, what did you have? You had from the elevator.
Quietly Sleep Away the Centuries.
Yeah, Sleep Away the Centuries is a literary device. Right? Cause that's, never mind. Okay. A memorable thought.
Hyperbole.
That's hyperbole. A memorable thought. None?
Oh, a memorable thought that you're asking?
Yeah.
Sorry. Reflections of the past are essential for us to last, for their linking spirits dwell within us and cast upon us wonderment and spiritual forces meant to strengthen and enlighten today's people with torches of wisdom.
Very good. Anybody else got one?
Kim had one.
Kim was busy.
I worked hard.
That's right.
Archaeologists read the long-buried artifacts like a novel, giving us insight into the past of these ancient people.
There you go. She's sucking up, by the way.
I am.
Cool. All right. Those of you that make some drawing things, stick them around here on the thing so everybody can else see what you've done.
Our beginning quote is from Marcel Proust, who says, "The voyage of discovery is not in seeking new landscapes, but in having new eyes." I think that portrays to here because we're going to be here, and the landscape is evolving, but we're going to be looking at it with our new eyes, our new way of seeing. Let's continue with the homework thing. Did anybody have any questions about your last time's homework? I noticed some wonderful acrostics. Did anybody want to share theirs? Does anybody have one they didn't put out that they? I was thinking this would be a nice addition to your Emma Kwan exhibit because people have their drawings and they have an acrostic and it's a lot of the organisms that you'll see here. And mostly all the information is factual, so it's going to be giving you an idea of what you'll be able to see.
There's one other thing about acrostic poems is I don't know if you know this, they're actually poems that people will read. Because it's friendly and, you know, it's not.
Yeah.
Which is important. If nobody reads it, then it.
Yeah.
Mine was Viceroy. Very like a monarch in color and design. Certainly you fool me each time you flit on by. Are you a regal monarch or an impish Viceroy, you little rascal?
That's very clever. Something else you might want to try, I did this with the word raven. This happens to be Michael's drawing, but I made the words look so they look like ravens in the sky. So it's raucous, acrobat, vibrant, ebony, nomad. So it's really simple, but yet it's a poem as well. So that's something you can try yourself. Paint chip. I love the one back there. What was it? Emma Kwan. Ekru with the eggs. I thought that was really, really clever. Anybody else have paint chip color that they'd like to share? Nobody? Huh? Oh, mud puddle. That's a good one.
What color is that?
Key lime?
Yeah,
what color is mud puddle?
My mud puddle is yellow.
Oh no, he drew his mud puddle.
Blue heron.
Blue heron, that's a good one.
Came out of a swamp.
Oh, yeah.
Anybody else?
Yeah, I had to find it. I on my set over there. I had picked blue heron, an iridescent gray with hints of blue steel and flecks of tan.
Anybody else? And finally, observation using the word. Did you find that hard when you were limited by that word for your observation? Did you even try? I noticed a couple people used it because I read there back there. Okay.
Short dark hair, one paper tail, streamlined shape, swims soundly through the water, trails.
Good observation. Something I forgot to point out, and I forgot to bring last time. This is for Language of the Landscape. This is a wonderful book called Home Ground, and it's by Barry Lopez. And it defines any geological, ecological term. Different authors or writers have defined them, and it's just a wonderful book to pick up, you know, at any spot and to read. And speaking of books, on the right behind your schedule today, I gave you a list of what I call references on display or used during the Forest Discovery 2010. So this book is on it, everything that I have back there and everything that I had in the back the last 3 weeks are on this list as well for you. And now Jane.
Water, clear liquid harmony, showers over me and quenches my thirst in the clean air after the early morning rain, which began with a torrent and ended with slow drops dripping from the leaves of the cottonwood. I approach that by doing the similes. I look like a clear liquid, I feel like liquid harmony, I taste like clean twin sugar, I smell like the air after it rains, I sound like the torrent of a waterfall or a slow trickle of fluid moving down the stream.
So you're putting things
fun.
Together.
Yeah,
good
it was
job.
Just fun.
Anybody else? Then we'll move on. Your first handout today and your writing handouts is called, I believe I called it Emaquan Final Harvest. It has sort of, it has what I wrote about the final harvest, but if you take a look on the back, all the information came from my observation notebook, and so that's on the back. So I just wanted to show you how I used my notebook to come up with the final product. And you can also see why this is dark. I spilled something on my observation notebook. So that's what happened there. I just wanted to show you an example. If I could have the lights. So we've been doing, you know, short journal entries. We've talked about poems. Sometimes, though, you've got it backwards. This is the last one.
What do you mean the last one?
I need writing from persona.
Oh. Okay.
Okay, thanks. As E.B. White said in one of my favorite books, it is a rare thing to find someone who is both a good friend and a good writer. Charlotte. Mm-hmm. Was both. Probably one of Charlotte's Web is a good example of writing from the persona. E.B. White wrote from the view of the rat, the pig, the spider. If you ever get a chance to hear the book on tape, he does the voices. It's great. Another good example is Watership Downs by Richard Adams. And one that I just recently found several years ago, this is called The Mob. And it's called The Crow Chronicles. And as I write here, the story is told by the first crow, Calm, and he tells him to move in. And if you can't see me, you probably can't hear me, so move in, move up the tree. And I like how he says he is old, or as he puts it, he is 38 springs that I have gripped the branch, 38 springs that the land has weighed my shadow. Calm is what is known as the chooser, and as the chooser, it's his job to collect and separate the strands of the memory, of the crow's memory that's related to him, and from them he weaves the nest that will shelter and preserve the family history. So the whole book is written in what they call crow speak. So I thought I'd give you a couple more examples. So this crow is saying, if you look closely, you can see that the big one is pointing a black square thing with a long tube on the front of it. And then Kip saw the human was holding something glossy and black. And immediately he raised his wings in alarm and said, a stinging human. So what would a stinging human be?
The gun.
A person with a gun. Then he says, I've seen them before. They point them. And as if the human heard her, it raised the black object and pressed it closely to its face. Then they wrapped their paws around them. And then if you listen carefully, and through the still air, a slight, thin, whirring sounded, like the thrumming of a partridge followed by a pair of muffled clicks. They're talking there about a camera. And finally, same with those black tubes humans press up against their faces, like two long eyes. See, those two have a pair of them too. The square black objects make a noise, the long eyes don't. But humans put them on and take them off and point them at each other all the time. And here they're talking about
binoculars.
So it's now your chance to step outside yourself, which is what writing from the persona is. It's because most humans are we're pretty much anthropocentric, we try to, you know, describe things in our own experiences and knowledge and value. But if we write from the persona, we're going to write from somebody else's. And I noticed, I think it was Kim, wrote one of her views from the view of a cone flower, which was very good.
Yeah, the daisy. Yeah.
So what I thought we'd do for the next few minutes, Micah will pass these out.
Oh, okay.
You're going to be given a picture. There's three pictures, and each picture, each thing that I give you, everybody gets, there's a ticket attached, and pretty soon that ticket will become, you know, you'll know what it's about, because that's your assigned picture that you have to write from the viewpoint of. Also, on the picture is some information. So the first picture is that of a great gray owl. I believe it was in the year 2005, there was an invasion of great gray owls in Duluth, Minnesota. Great gray owls are the world's largest owl, and these owls are dependent upon cycles of rodent prey. In 2005, the rodent prey had crushed up north, further north, so they came down to Minnesota, and you were able to see about, well, we saw 50 great gray owls in one day. They had counted over 700 great gray owls. Another thing about great grays is they eat up to one-third of their weight in rodents daily. And as someone said, it's as if there's a big whippersnail on bowls, and great gray owls are the only consumers in the store. The next picture that you might write from, if you're assigned, is the girl. The woman holding the owl is a bird bander from the Powder Mill Biological Station. This is one of the longest continually running bird banding stations in the country. And they came down for about 1 week to band some of the great gray owls during this owl invasion. And in one day, they were able to band 10 great gray owls, which set a new U.S. single day record. If you turn the... she's holding a real great gray owl. And if you turn the back of the page, you have the bull, and all your information says about the bull is unfortunately at or near the bottom of the food chain. So here are our pictures. We have the girl, we have the bull, and we have the owl. And take a look at your tickets, people with yellow tickets. Write from the perspective or persona of the girl. Green, you are the owl. And blue, you are the bowl. And I will give you 10 minutes.
And you could be the owl on the right, or you could be the owl being held.
Right, so you could be either this owl or this owl. There's only one. Yellow is the girl.
Yellow is the girl. You write a short paragraph, whatever, from the persona of one you can get.